iodine to form the precursor for the thyroid hormone. So this, if there is no thyroglobulin, or we can say tyrosine residue of the thyroglobulin, then it is impossible to synthesize the thyroid hormones, because to iodinate it or to combine the iodine to form the precursors of the thyroid hormones, we require the thyroglobulin. So this is the first steps for the synthesis of thyroid hormone. So if you look back to this transporter, so this transporter, we call it as the sodium iodide transporters, okay? Sodium iodide transporter. And these transporters is also called as the sodium iodide symporter. So why symporter? Because we see that here the two ions, iodide and the sodium, it moves in the same direction. So we call it as the symporter. And this symporter, it belongs to the active transport. So why? Because we are going to transport these iodides again, electrical and chemical gradient. Okay. We are going to transport these iodides against the electrical and chemical gradient. So we call this transporter as an active transporter, or a sodium iodide transporters. Okay. Now this transporter, this sodium iodide transporters, it lies on the Bessel's membranes of the follicular epithelial cell. Now once this iodide, it moves inside the follicular cells, follicular epithelial cells, then it gets transferred to the apical membrane. Okay. So don't confuse here. In the apical membrane, there is also the presence of the another transporter for the iodide. Okay. So in most of the books related to the pharmacology, they have mentioned the another channels presence on the apical membrane. And what you should don't confuse here is that if you don't remember the name of the proteins available in the apical membrane, it's okay. Okay, so go through the reference towards the physiology and the biochemistry. But in pharmacology book, like in K.D. Tripathi and in Kadjong and most of the book, they have mentioned the one proteins presence in the apical membrane, and these proteins or these channels, they are responsible for the transport of this iodide to the follicular lumen. Okay, so don't confuse here. What we should understand here is that if iodide, it enters into the follicular epithelial cell, then this iodide, it moves towards the follicular lumen. Okay. So now what happens here, the first reactions occurs, we call it at the oxidation reactions. Okay. So what is oxidation reactions? It means that we are going to convert the iodide into the iodine. Okay, iodide, the conversion of iodide into the iodine is called at the oxidation reactions. And for these reactions, we required enzymes called at the thyroid peroxidase enzymes. That means these enzymes plays important role to form the iodine. And we have formed the tyrosine residue of the thyroglobulin. Okay, and this tyrosine residue of the thyroglobulin, it gets iodinated, or we can say iodination reactions takes place. Okay. And this tyrosine residue of the thyroglobulin, it binds to the iodine, and it forms the precursor for the thyroid hormones, or we can say it forms the MIT and DIT. Okay. So the reactions catalyzed from this point to this point, we require the same enzymes called as the thyroid peroxidase enzymes. So thyroid peroxidase enzymes, the first enzymes to convert the iodide to the iodine, and catalytic reaction is that the organification reactions takes place. This thyroid peroxidase also helps to combine the iodine to the tyrosine residue of the thyroglobulins to forms the MIT and DIT. So MIT means monoiodotyrosines and DIT means diiodotyrosine. So this process, we call it at the organification reactions. Okay. Now here occurs the coupling reaction. So coupling reactions means this one molecules of the DIT, it combines to the one molecules of the MIT, it forms the T3. And if MIT, DIT molecules, it combines with the DIT, diiodotyrosine molecules, then it forms the T4. Okay, so here we understand there are two chemical reactions to forms the T3 and T4. Okay, MIT plus DIT T3, DIT plus DIT T4. Now these reactions, out of these two chemical reactions, the formation of T4, the formation of T4 hormones occurs more. That means the concentration of the formation of T4 is more than the concentration of T3. And now this T4, T3, MIT, DIT all gets incorporated to the tyrosine residue of the thyroglobulins, or we can say thyroglobulins. Okay, and this thyroglobulin complex, T3, T4, MIT, DIT, they all get stored in the lumen of the follicular cells as a collide. And these colloidal molecules, they get endocytes, or they enter inside the follicular epithelial cells by the process of endocytosis. And it gets enters inside the follicular epithelial cells. And once the thyroid gland get stimulated by the impulse, then this T3 and T4, they get released to the circulation. And this MIT and DIT, they again recycle back for the formation of thyroid gland. Okay. Now, if this T3 and T4 once reaches to the blood circulations, what we came to know here is that the concentration or the amount of T4 is more than T3, but the active form of thyroid hormones, or the hormones which exerts the pharmacological response or physiological response, we require the T3. But what we came to know here is that in the circulations we have large amount of T4. Now what happens here? This T4, it gets converted to T3. This T4, it gets converted to the T3 in the peripheral tissue, by the enzymes called as the 5' deiodinase. Okay, 5' deiodinase, or we can say there occurs the peripheral conversion of T4 to T3. Now this T3, it binds to the respective receptors, and then they exerts the pharmacological response. Okay, so in this way we have discussed the formation, or we have discussed the synthesis of the thyroid hormones, we have discussed the storage of the thyroid hormones, and we have discussed the release of the thyroid hormones. So this is the basic physiological and the biochemical reactions that occurs in the follicular cells of the thyroid gland. Okay, so now what our main purpose is that if you understand the steps, for the synthesis of for the hormones, now we are going to place the name of the drugs so that we are going to decrease the synthesis, or we are going to decrease the amount of secretion of thyroid hormones in case of hyperthyroidism. Okay, so you should keep in your mind is that once this T3 and T4 it released to the blood circulation, these molecules, they are highly protein bind molecules. Okay, they are highly protein binding molecules. That means the protein binding molecules, we call it as the thyroxine binding molecules. These molecules, they get highly bind to the thyroxine binding proteins, and they are available in the bound form. So to exert the pharmacological response, we require a free form of the molecules in order to activate its respective receptors. Okay, so these are the basic steps. So first step is that we are going to trap the iodides. Okay, we are going to trap the iodides. Trapping of the iodides takes place. Second reactions, oxidation reaction takes place. Third reactions, iodination reactions takes place, or organification reactions takes place. And fourth reactions, there occurs the coupling reactions, and then there occurs the secretion of thyroid hormones into the blood circulations. Okay, so now we are going to place the name of the drugs. Okay, so and then we have discussed in case of hypothyroidism. In case of hypothyroidism, we have two drugs. We call it as the levothyroxine and leothyronin. So this levothyroxine, it is a T4 molecules, whereas leothyronin is T3. Okay, so just keep in your mind is that for the treatment purpose of hypothyroidism, these molecules are, we require the replacement therapy for the treatment purpose of hypothyroidism. And out of these two molecules, levothyroxine and leothyronin, we are going to prefer levothyroxine. Why? Because of the various factors that affects for choosing the levothyroxine and leothyronin. Okay, so if you compare the pharmacokinetics parameters of these two molecules, we came to know that levothyroxine, they have slow onset of actions, okay, and they have longer duration of actions, okay, and leothyronin, they have fast onset of actions, whereas they have shorter duration of actions, okay. So in terms of these points, we can easily say that the half-life of the levothyroxine is more compared to the leothyronin, okay. So I hope you understand the term of onset of actions and duration of actions, okay. So in majority of the case, in pharmacology, if onset of action and duration of action comes, if a molecules has fast onset of actions, it has shorter duration of actions. Keep it in your mind, okay. If a molecule has short onset of action, they have longer duration of actions, okay. So as we know, in emergency conditions, we choose the drugs, we choose the molecules which has a fast onset of actions, okay, but for majority of the case, hypothyroidism cases, like in case of cretinism, in case of myxedema, and in case of the endemic goiter, okay, so for all these case, we require a levothyroxines, okay, we are not going to use the leothyronin. But why we are going to choose this levothyroxines? There are various factors, but you should not forget that leothyronin has high chances to cause the cardiac arrhythmia, okay. It has high chances to cause the cardiac arrhythmia. When we move to the levothyroxine, it has less chances to cause the cardiac arrhythmia. So remove these drawbacks of the leothyronin, we are going to use the levothyroxines. And there are various factors. As I have told you that the levothyroxine, it has more stability, it has uniform content, low cost, and it is lack of allergenic foreign proteins, and laboratory measurement of serum levels is very easy in terms of levothyroxine. And as we know, it has long half-life, which permits the once daily to weekly administration. Okay, this point is also very, very important for you. So when you compare this levothyroxine to the leothyronin, leothyronin, when you go to the onset of actions, okay, so which molecule has fast onset of actions, okay, please can you tell me which out of these two molecules which has fast onset of action?
Leothyronin.
Okay, and which has longer duration of actions?
Levothyroxine.
So out of these two molecules, which has greater chances to cause the cardiac arrhythmia?
Leothyronin.
Okay, very good. Okay, now we move towards the comparison. We have compared this levothyroxine and leothyronin at these slides. Okay, so these are the therapeutic uses. So today's our main, but here one question comes for you. Okay, if they ask for the drug of choice for myxedema coma, then you have to write the levothyroxine, okay. If they ask drug of choice for myxedema coma, then you have to write the levothyroxine. But if they ask like this, so what is your correct answer in this condition? You can read it out the questions and choose one specific answer for these questions. Leothyronine is preferred over levothyroxine in which of the following condition? Why are we going to use leothyronine in this case? Say the reason ki no like.
Onset of.
Onset of actions. Okay. So leothyronine has fast onset of actions. Okay. Your answer is correct. So for these questions, mexidomycoma is right answer. For if they ask for this drug of choice for mexidomycoma, then you have to write the levothyroxine. Okay. Don't confuse at these two points. So this is the summary for the thyroid hormone synthesis. Now, antithyroid drugs. This is our main topics for today. So antithyroid drugs, as the name indicates, that these drugs, they are used to reduce the amount of thyroid hormones by different mechanism. First, these drugs either inhibits the synthesis of thyroid hormones mechanism, or these drugs decrease the secretion of thyroid hormones from the follicular cells to the blood circulations. Okay. Or these drugs performs both functions, that means they can inhibit the synthesis or they can inhibit the release of thyroid hormones to the blood circulations. Or simply we can say the drug reduces the level of thyroid hormones either by inhibiting the synthesis of hormones or by blocking the release of hormones, or by both phenomena. So this group of drugs, we classified them as the antithyroid drugs. Okay, we classified them as the antithyroid drugs. So if you look these pictures, now here, you can say that what is this steps we called it as?
Iodine trapping.
What is the steps we called in this process?
Iodide trapping.
Iodide trapping, very good. So after the iodide trapping, then this iodide, it gets converted to the iodine, you know, it gets converted to the iodine, and this iodine, it gets conjugated, or it gets binds to the tyrosine residue of the thyroglobulins, and then it forms, it undergoes the organification reactions, you know. And then it will get released into the blood. So this is our basic mechanism to understand the synthesis process of the thyroid hormones. Okay. So now you can estimate the how we are going to reduce the thyroid hormones levels by seeing these pictures. Okay. By seeing in which step you are going to put the drugs. So that it decreases the amount of thyroid hormones. Okay, first, okay, very good. That means iodide symporter inhibitors. Okay, we are going to inhibit the iodide trapping. Good. Next, second, peroxidase inhibitors. That means we are going to inhibit the functions of the thyroid peroxidase. Okay, so this thyroid peroxidase, they are responsible for three chemical reactions. Okay, oxidation, organification, and coupling reactions. That means we came to know that if you inhibit the functions of the thyroid peroxidase enzymes, then we can say that we classified such group of drugs under the hormone synthesis inhibitors. Okay, so the first drug group of drugs were iodide trapping inhibitors or iodide inhibitors, and second, hormone synthesis inhibitor. Third, thank you, Unchava. Very good. Secretion inhibitor, hormone release inhibitor. Okay. First, in this inhibitor, second, synthesis inhibitors, and third is release inhibitor. We are not going to let the T3 and T4 to move towards the blood. Okay. So at last, fourth group of drugs. What is your fourth group of drugs to reduce the amount of thyroid hormones? Very good. Peripheral conversion inhibitors. Okay. So for the peripheral conversion, which enzyme is responsible to convert T4 to T3?
5' deiodinase.
Okay. 5' deiodinase. Okay. So you can say, so now you can say that the classification of antithyroid drugs, first is iodide trapping inhibitors, second is hormone synthesis inhibitors, third is hormone release inhibitors, and fourth is peripheral conversion inhibitors. Okay, so look here, these pictures again, it gives more clarity. Iodide trapping inhibitors, they are the drugs. Okay, we will see in the classifications. So this classification is made according to the site of actions, according to the site of actions, and these iodides, thioamides, they are responsible for the thyroid hormone synthesis inhibitors, okay. And this iodide is also responsible to inhibit the proteolysis process, and these beta blockers, they are responsible for the peripheral conversion. Okay, so you can say the classifications of the antithyroid drugs. Saksa aba bhanna aba classify garna saksa aile. You don't require the name of the drugs, just you need the group of the drugs that we classified under the antithyroid drugs. If you destroy the follicular cells, then what happens? If you give the rays of the light to destroy the follicular cells, then what happens? Now we are able to reduce the concentration of the thyroid hormones or not, if you destroy the follicular cells. So the fifth group of drugs is the thyroid follicular cells, or we are going to destroy the follicular cells. Okay, thyroid tissue destroyed, fifth group of drugs. Okay, so this is our classification, sorry. And now roll number 35.
Yes, sir.
Okay, 35. So can you give the name group of the drugs under the antithyroid drugs?
The first is iodide trapping inhibitor, hormone synthesis inhibitors.
Very and good.
Third is hormone releasing inhibitors.
Very and
fourth is peripheral conversion inhibitor. And the drugs that destroy the thyroid gland.
Drugs that destroy the thyroid tissue. Okay, okay, now we are going to write the classification of antithyroid drugs. So these are the classification of antithyroid drugs. As we know, the first is hormone synthesis inhibitors. Okay, copy it down, okay, in your copy, because in books they have given in different ways, so that you can confuse while comparing the notes of mine and to the book. So please copy these slides for the classification of antithyroid drugs. If in examinations, if they ask, examiner asks for you, then you have to write these classifications. Please be sure. Hormone synthesis inhibitors, in this group of drugs, we classify propylthiouracil, methimazole, and carbimazole. Propylthiouracil, methimazole, and carbimazole, and inhibits iodide trapping, or we can say ionic inhibitors. In this, we classified the thiocyanates and perchlorates. And third, hormone release inhibitors. Okay, in this we keep the iodine, iodides of sodium and potassium, and organic iodides. Okay, iodine, iodides of sodium and potassium, organic iodides. This group of drugs is under the hormone release inhibitors. And the fourth is the thyroid tissue destroying agents. Thyroid tissue destroying agents. In this, we are going to use the radioactive iodines. Okay, radioactive iodines. So if you mention these four group of the drugs, it is very good. But in fifth, you can also add the peripheral conversion inhibitors like the beta blockers. Okay, if you use the beta blockers as a peripheral conversion inhibitors, you can add it on the classification of the antithyroid drugs. But you must note the four points: hormone synthesis inhibitors, inhibits iodide trapping, hormone release inhibitors, thyroid tissue destroying agents. Okay, so today we are just going to discuss these two groups: hormone synthesis inhibitors and the inhibits iodide trapping or ionic inhibitors. Okay, we are just going to see the mechanism of actions, therapeutic uses, and adverse effects of these two drugs. Okay, so look here. For this group, okay, hormone synthesis inhibitors, for this group of drugs, hormone synthesis inhibitors, you have propylthiouracil, methimazole and carbimazole. Okay, you have methimazole and carbimazole. And nowadays, from this group of drugs, we are going to use the carbimazoles. Okay, lots of the countries, they are going to use the carbimazoles. And the propyl thiouracils, they are not using. Okay, but propyl thiouracil, it is the drug of choice as an anti-thyroid drugs during the pregnancy. Okay, during the pregnancy, anti-thyroid drugs, we are going to use the propyl thiouracil. Why? Because all the drugs that we classified under the anti-thyroid drugs, they can cause the teratogenic effects except the propyl thiouracils. Okay, why propyl thiouracils? As we know, this propyl thiouracil has highest binding capacity to the protein, plasma protein. Okay, it has highest capacity to bind to the plasma protein, so that the free molecules of the propyl thiouracil, they cannot cross the placental membrane, or they cannot cross the placenta. Okay, so because of this reason, propyl thiouracils is the drug of choice for the first trimesters of the pregnancy to treat the hyperthyroidism conditions. And this rest of the drugs, they can cause the teratogenic effects. Okay, so if you see the mechanism of actions of these hormones, hormone synthesis inhibitors, okay, for the synthesis of hormones, what enzymes you require? Which enzymes you require for the synthesis of hormones?
Thyroxine peroxidase.
Thyroid peroxidase. Okay, that means what we came to know, that this group of drugs, they binds and inhibits the functions of thyroid peroxidase enzymes. Okay, they binds and inhibits the functions of thyroid peroxidase enzymes. That means they inhibits the which chemical reactions? They inhibits the oxidation reaction, they inhibits the organification reactions, they inhibits the coupling reactions, and finally this group of drugs are responsible to reduce the thyroid hormones. Okay, to reduce the amount of thyroid hormones. Now, can you understand the mechanism of action of this all group hormone synthesis inhibitors? Mechanism of action bujhe ki bujhe na
bujhe
ai ekdam sajilo cha. What you should understand here is that these all drugs, propyl thiouracil or methimazole or carbimazole, they binds and inhibits the functions of thyroid peroxidase enzyme. If this thyroid peroxidase enzyme's functions get inhibited, the oxidation reactions, organification reactions, and coupling reactions get inhibited, and finally there occurs the reduction, or there reduce the formations of the thyroid hormones. Okay, this is our mechanism of actions. Okay, so if you move to the point number 2, inhibits iodide trapping. So what is the mechanism of actions of thiocyanates and perchlorates? Aba you can say, what is the mechanism of action of thiocyanates and perchlorates?
Sodium iodide importer inhibitor.
Very good. They inhibits the sodium iodide symporter. Just inhibits the sodium iodide symporter. Now you can understand the mechanism of action. By looking this points, hormone release inhibitor, you can easily understand the mechanism of actions, and tissue destroying agents, you can also easily say the mechanism of action of a thyroid tissue destroying agents. And we will discuss the mechanism of actions of hormone release inhibitors and thyroid tissue destroying agents in next class. Okay, so so when you compare these two drugs, okay, or we can say these ionic inhibitors, they are not used clinically. Okay, just keep it in your mind. We are not going to discuss detailedly regarding to the ionic inhibitors. Why? Because these ionic inhibitors, they are highly toxic. Because of the high toxic natures, this group of drugs, they are not used clinically. That means we can throw it out from our anti-thyroid group of drugs. Okay, so for the classification, you must note it on the classification point, but regarding to the explanation of the ionic inhibitors, here of course no need to study. Okay, why? Because of the highly toxic natures, we are not going to use the ionic inhibitors. Okay, so this group of drugs, they are widely used. Okay, so if you see here, so in which point, at this point, which group of drugs gets act at this point? Banata roll number 78 le banata which group of drugs act at this site? 78.
Yes, sir. Iodine trapping inhibitors.
Oh, iodide trapping inhibitors. Very good, very good. So for these points, for oxidation reaction, for organification reaction, and the coupling reactions, which group of drugs you require to inhibit these chemical reactions?
Thioamides, sir.
Thioamides, very good. Okay. Now I hope you all understand. Okay. Please be active. Okay. Thank you for today.